Listening Library presents Not an Easy Win by Chrystal D. Giles. Read for you by Nile Bullock, with an author's note read by the author. For my grandmother, Henrietta, the center of my village. Chapter 1. Expelled. I was pretty sure that meant I was being kicked out of school forever. Principal Spacey didn't even bother to look at me when he handed the sentence down. I'd been warned after my last fight. The next time you walk into my office will be your last, he'd said. That was just 4 weeks ago, when I'd had 6 fists pounding my head into the pavement. I wouldn't call that a fight. It was more like a beatdown. This time it was just 2 fists and 1 foot. I was able to escape before it got too bloody. I even threw a couple of punches of my own. I had actually become pretty good at taking hits. My skin had gotten harder to hurt. But like Mr. Spacey said, it didn't matter who'd started the fight. Just that it had happened. And it had happened to me one too many times. Even if Billy Jakes had gotten into just as many fights. Mr. Spacey treated our school like it was some kind of jail. He was the warden instead of the principal. Always walking around talking about maintaining law and order. He couldn't wait to get rid of me. And only me. I could hear the frustration in Ma's voice from my spot outside Mr. Spacey's office. Please give him one more chance, she said. Please. I hated hearing her beg, especially since it wouldn't help. This was my last chance. I tried to get Ma to transfer me to another school after the last fight. Andrew Jackson Middle School was no place for me. I never fit in here, and I never would. I sat there listening to him explain to Ma that I was a distraction, and he wouldn't tolerate my disregard for the rules he'd put in place for his school. He dismissed her, and me, by saying, "That is all." Ma held her head up high and walked out of his office, past me in the waiting area, past the pale-faced office ladies, and out the front door. I slow-walked behind her, waiting to hear how this was all my fault. "Now what you gonna do?" Ma asked me, after we were out of earshot of the nosy office people. "Me? What about them?" I shrugged. I didn't know what I was gonna do, and I didn't care. Honestly, I hoped I'd never see this place again. Ma went on talking, more to herself than to me. "You wasting my gas coming back and forth up here to the school." And just like that, this was my fault. I looked forward and kept walking toward the parking lot. With each step, I winced. A rib shot was the worst kind of pain. Way worse than a shot to the face. When we got to the car, I hesitated. Ma was in a fussing mood. And I'd have to listen to this all the way to Granny's house. "Get in!" Ma yelled. Her calm was completely undone now. "You're 12 years old! Too old for this!" I went over to the passenger side of the car and waited for Ma to open the door. That door didn't open from the outside anymore. It had just stopped working one day. No one knew why, but that was probably my fault too. "The only job you have is to go to school, and you can't even do that," Ma started in again. "If you aren't in school, you'll have to find some kind of way to help out. Your granny won't let you sit around the house all day." "I can just leave," I said under my breath. "Where you gonna go?" Ma spat out. I didn't have an answer. I stared out the window into the gloomy air. The gray sky stared back. She was right. I was trapped. We rode in silence for exactly 22 minutes before we turned off the main road onto Bumpy Poke Lane. Granny Street wasn't a dirt road, but it wasn't smooth pavement either. After lots of driving on and no fixing, it was mostly broken up pieces of asphalt now. Mom pulled off the cracked road into Granny's gravel driveway and turned the car off. She let out a deep breath.
Look, Lawrence, this ain't all on you. Life is hard, and we've had a double dose of hard lately.
Ma's voice was softer now, her version of an apology. I knew I'd never get the real thing. Ma wasn't the apologizing type. Whenever I did something wrong, I had to apologize. I wasn't sure why adults didn't have to. For a moment, I'd forgotten about my stinging left eye. It would double in size if I didn't get ice on it soon. I sat in the thick air of Ma's car, waiting for her to ask about it, or at least see if I was okay. 2 long minutes passed. Silence.
All right, let's just go in and get it over with.
Ma sighed.
If she says something, we'll just say it wasn't your fault.
It wasn't my fault, I wanted to yell out, but I knew it wouldn't matter. No one cared about what had really happened. No one cared that I'd had a huge target on me since the day I started at that school. Everyone just looked at me like I was the problem. Chapter 2. Granny stood in the front doorway watching as me and Ma climbed the steps. Her hand was on her hip, and her lips were fixed to start a fire.
Mama, before you start, it wasn't his fault, Ma began. Them kids at that school have been picking on him since he got there.
I wish she said that to Principal Spacey, or to me.
Tracy, you make so many excuses for that boy,
Granny said, ignoring me. Ma brushed past Granny and went inside. Following Ma's lead, I slid by Granny and headed straight to the back bedroom. I slumped on the bed and tried to take advantage of the quiet before the house filled with running feet and screaming kids. My little sister, Nico, and our twin cousins would be here soon. I peeled off my ripped hoodie and tossed it on the floor. Johnson C. Smith University was printed on the front in faded gold letters. That hoodie was what had started the fight that got me expelled. Maybe I could blame Uncle Benny, Pop's brother. He'd given me the hoodie for Christmas last year. Not that it had anything to do with them, but the kids at Andrew Jackson used it as a reason to start messing with me.
What kind of college is that?
I think that came from Colson Sims, or maybe Brett Masters. Their yappy voices spun around in my head.
Where'd you get that shirt?
He probably stole it.
You ain't going to college.
He don't even know what college is.
I wasn't about to let that slide.
Andrew Jackson was full of white kids who always got their way. At least it seemed like it to me. Sometimes they needed a lesson in how to treat people. Sometimes was today.
Lawrence, get in here and help with dinner, Granny called.
I sighed and headed to the kitchen, where Granny stood waiting for me. We were having salmon patties again. Yuck. The stinky smell smacked me in the face as Granny drained the liquid from the can and emptied the fish into a bowl. My stomach turned.
Your hands better be clean, she said, not even looking at me.
Washing my hands in Granny's kitchen sink was a huge no. So I walked back through the living room, down the short hall, and into the bathroom. I passed Ma on the way. She was slumped on the couch, trying to get a nap after a shift at the diner. I tried not to look at her. At the sink, I let the water pour over my bruised hands. The cool burn felt like everything else in my life, numbing and mismatched.
Mixing the mayo and egg,
And make the patties while I boil the rice, Granny said when I got back.
Yes, ma'am.
I cracked the egg and dumped it in the mayo into the bowl. I smashed a gummy, fishy-smelling mixture with my hand.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.